Quest presents an unabridged recording of None by Robin Roughley, narrated by Charlie Sanderson and Ben Allen.
Chapter 1. One of the greatest gifts that can be bestowed upon the young is the knowledge of what they want to be as they grow into adulthood. These are the blessed children. The ones who will go on to become prefects, the ones who would never dream of missing a homework deadline. They instinctively listen to what the teachers have to say because they know it will stand them in good stead as they follow their preordained path in life to greatness. They will become the businessmen and women of the future, the leaders, the success stories. They are pragmatic in all they do. Every decision they make is carefully considered, using rational thought processes, using facts and irrefutable data. At the opposite end of the spectrum are the autistic ones, ruled by the right hemisphere of the brain. They yearn to be thespians, painters, musicians, writers. To the blessed ones, the autistic mob are fools who should be shown no pity or understanding for their delusions. The last group are the ones who are completely clueless about where life will take them and seemingly have no interest in learning anything. These are the ones who tend to belong to the collective. At school, they move around in groups and are usually either bullies or they're weak, though the weak ones are often smart enough to ingratiate themselves with the bullies to avoid being bullied themselves. The collective secretly craves fame and fortune, the shortcut to a life of glamour, though they're clueless about how they'll actually get there, ill-equipped as they are to make their mark in life. Finally, there are the oddities, the strange ones, the loners who seem to exist on the periphery of everything. Ruben Jones is one such oddity, though from a young age he had always known his path in life. From the start of his teenage years, his mind had been focused on one thing and one thing only. Ruben Jones wanted to be a serial killer. However, wanting to be a serial killer is not something you can discuss with anyone. For example, you cannot talk to a careers advisor at school and say, "I want to butcher as many people as I can and never get caught." Dark thoughts torment the young as they pass through puberty, when hormones are most active and emotions veer wildly like some oarless vessels cast adrift on tumultuous seas. In most cases, the crashing waves eventually subside, leaving the erstwhile tormented soul to sail on in life, heading for their own safe harbour, dark thoughts and imagery fading as adult life asserts itself. Yet for Ruben Jones, the killer urge hadn't simply been a phase he'd been passing through. No, it had been a true calling, a vocation, and one he'd never considered relinquishing. If you think about it rationally, then how many people managed to do the job they dreamed of in those strange adolescent years? In some cases, the ones who wanted to be a doctor are now dentists, or vice versa. And the ones who wanted to be a star are now locked into the drudgery of some menial job, the kind of job that rots the brain, that drains any self-belief, and replaces it with the horror of living a pointless life. In order to try to deny the drudgery of their existence, they sing karaoke at the weekend when they're tanked up on cider. But that's as far as their dreams will ever go, and before they know it, Monday morning arrives, and they're back at work and once more part of the collective, while secretly wishing they were dead. Of course, Ruben Jones had to keep his real ambition in life a secret. After all, he had no choice in the matter. Though he'd also known that to achieve his full potential, then he had to have a plan B, a facade that he could hide behind, something that would lead others to think that he was normal. This had required a certain amount of soul-searching on his part, but in the end, he'd decided that after leaving school, then going to college to study, art would offer him a way to appear busy, while secretly pursuing his true calling in life. Art, by its very nature, is abstract. There is no wrong or right. It can be faked and yet appear intense. You can wax lyrical about your vision, about what you're trying to say with your wild splashes of nonsensical colours on a blank canvas. More than one of his teachers had looked at the work he produced and nodded, as if understanding some great inner mystery tuned into what Ruben was trying to convey.
I love the vibrancy. I love the visceral feel of the piece, was a favourite response to something he'd thrown together in 10 minutes.
The class had been encouraged to discuss one another's work with a critic's eye. Ruben would involve himself in these debates, passionate and outspoken, a defender of anyone's right to express themselves. The trouble was, he never believed a word that fell from his own lips, let alone anyone else's. That was a lesson he'd learnt at home, and soon he'd become adept at the art of lying.
"Have you done your homework?"
his father had asked on a regular basis.
"All done,"
Ruben would reply, safe in the knowledge that his father never actually checked to see if his son was telling the truth. As soon as the penny dropped that there were no consequences of lying, Ruben Jones had for a time lied about everything, until even he couldn't detect whether he was telling the truth or not.
"What have you done today at school?"
his mother would occasionally inquire in a voice that he would soon learn was her "I'm asking, though I don't really care" voice.
"Double maths, double history, art and masturbation," he would reply, knowing she wouldn't even bother listening to his answer.
"That's nice," she would say absently, simultaneously watching the television while ironing and ploughing her way through a tin of roses, including the hard caramels, the only ones he liked.
At times like this, Ruben would picture his mother dead in a waterlogged ditch with a garrote around her neck, the victim of some faceless killer who cared nothing for ironing or hard caramels. For a time, he tried to understand the urge to kill, tried to rationalize why he felt that way. Then he'd given up before he even started. The main thing was, it made him feel good both mentally and physically. Aged 13, he'd discovered himself similar to other boys at that tumultuous age, and he would do the things that all young boys at the start of their teenage years did, including hanging around in the local paper shop, pretending to peruse the magazines on any subject from equestrian pursuits to photography and the Build Your Own Battleship in 50 Monthly Installments magazine. Yet in truth, his eyes had always swiveled up toward the top shelf. That is where the tantalizing magazines were kept, the ones that showed the perfect curve of a bare breast or a long leg encased in a stocking, though the frustrating thing was that the next magazine in line would always cover the previous one. So he would stand there wondering at the stirring in his Y-front, until he ended up with a headache and occasionally seeing double with the eye strain of looking up. Then, one day, on the way home from school, he'd found a copy of Fiesta that had been tossed into a tangle of brambles, and he'd suffered scratched arms and legs as he fought his way to the prize. The magazine had been damp, as if it had been out there all night, and he even pictured the person who had tossed it away, some old perv smiling as he imagined a young adolescent boy battling with Mother Nature to get at the magazine. Ruben had been that boy, that teenager, and he'd shoved the magazine down the front of his trousers, covering the top half with his grey school jumper. On arriving home, he'd gone straight to his bedroom and tried to find the perfect place to hide the damp copy of Fiesta. This had included lifting his mattress with the intention of placing it there. Then he dismissed the idea, fearful that his mother could change the bedding and find it. So he'd peeled the carpet back in the corner of the room. But once the mag was in place, it had left a small hump in the Axminster, so once more he'd abandoned the hiding place. In the end, he'd hidden it on top of the wardrobe, along with the spiders and mummified flies, before heading back downstairs.
"Have you done your homework?"
his father had been at the dinner table, a plate of something that looked inedible in front of him.
"Most of it, but I'll finish the rest later," Ruben had lied.
"Make sure you do."
His father had glanced up at him, his wayward eyebrows meeting in the middle. Ruben had nodded before heading outside, desperate to kill time until he could safely retire to his bedroom to study the magazine in detail. The following day, he'd thrust the Fiesta into the bin, frustrated and hot-faced. Most of the pages had been stuck together with what looked like the glue they would use at school during art lessons. It had been a letdown, and the sense of aggravation had remained with him for a few days, along with the strange stirring in his pants. Occasionally, he would eavesdrop on the collective at school, mindful not to get too close in case he drew attention to himself. The ringleader, the cock of the walk, had been Banksy Walliams, who had surrounded himself with inadequate cronies, kids who would do anything he said, not because they worshipped him, but because they knew if they didn't, then Walliams was more than capable of turning on them like a rabid dog. They would laugh at his puerile antics that normally included random acts of violence against the smaller kids. Ruben hated Walliams with a passion, and that had been before Walliams had cornered him in the schoolyard, tightening Ruben's tie until the circulation to his head had been cut off. Banksy Walliams had loved to big himself up, craving the attention. His tales would vary in size and scope. One moment he could be waxing lyrical about getting a handjob from a girl called Effie in the drama theatre, hiding from view by the stage curtains. "I shot my load all over her satchel," he'd guffawed, and his mates had joined in. Then he'd proclaimed that he'd beaten up 5 men the night before because one of them had looked at him funny. In the end, Ruben had moved away, bored with the nonsense. He had gone back to the refectory for a second serving of treacle sponge pudding with thick white sauce. One of his favourites.
Chapter 2. Do you believe in love at first sight? It's an age-old question, and some believe it utterly. No doubt those who are ruled by the right side of the brain will agree that love can be found in a brief glance across a crowded room, or through the window of a departing train as it leaves the station, taking what could have been the love of their life with it. While the more analytical ones snort in derision at the notion, believing in nothing but the practical. Not for them is that feeling of instant infatuation. They believe that relationships must be worked at, approached with stealth and guile, and the thought of a joint bank account is an anathema to them and always will be. Then you have the familiar platitudes that are offered as a balm to those who are unlucky in love. There's someone out there for everyone. These are the words a mother might utter to a distraught daughter as she cries into her pillow because her boyfriend had chucked her. Fathers, on the other hand, will often try a different tack with their sons. "Don't worry, lad, plenty more fish in the sea," or "pebbles on the beach." Ros Smith used to believe in love, believed in it big time. The only trouble was she'd never seen the spark, never felt the thrill of seeing your soulmate across a crowded room. At school, she'd considered all the boys in her class to be crass, ignorant, and infantile, and she'd spent a lot of those school-age years dreaming up ways to murder them. She'd even kept a diary at home with a padlock on the front. The pages had been filled with tales of shooting her classmates with some imaginary high-powered machine gun, the ones that are guaranteed not to miss the target. There were stabbings in there as well, along with an axe killing that had seen the headmaster playing the leading role of victim. His only lines consisted of, "No, please, God, no," repeated over and over until the axe split his comb over in two. If she had to pick a favourite, then it would be a toss-up between the hangings, burning at the stake, or the gift that kept on giving, the perennial frenzied knife attack. In her mind, nearly everyone at her school had been eviscerated at one time or another. Everyone, apart from one boy. His name had been Reuben Jones, and for some reason, he'd never played the part of victim in her wild imaginings. Now, aged 28, she still found herself thinking about Ruben, but more importantly, the daydreams of mass murder were still her constant companions. On leaving school, she'd gone to college to study art for much the same reasons that Ruben Jones had chosen the same subject, although, of course, that had been unknown to either of them at the time. Now, she works in a mundane office, her days spent in front of a computer pretending to work while conjuring up ways to slaughter her colleagues. The diary she had as a teenager is at the bottom of her underwear drawer, along with five others. She often finds it difficult to comprehend that when she wrote the first diary, the drawer had been full of trainer bras and plain-looking, sensible underwear. Although the bras had grown in cup size, her underwear still is bland. After all, what was the point in buying anything provocative when you have no interest in the opposite sex, or any sex, come to that? The infatuation, the yearning she'd felt at school to see her soulmate in another's eyes, had all but died away. Now all she had left was the vibrator she kept in a shoebox beneath her single bed, the batteries having long since died through lack of use. "Have you finished that work yet, Roz?" She blinked and looked at the man who stood by her desk. His name was Donny Froome, and Roz had killed him in every way possible, though she always came back to the frenzied knife attack. The blade, plunging into Froome's right eye, was a particular favourite. "Almost done, Mr. Froome," she lied. "Well, chop chop. I want it emailed to me by the end of play." In her mind, Roz could hear the axe descend as she cut off his arms and legs. Chop chop. The weighty blade biting into the heavy-duty carpet tiles that cover the office floor. "I'll make sure it's done in time," she replied in a deadpan voice. Froome frowned as he turned and strode away from her desk. Roz pictured him on the stumps of his amputated legs. If he still had arms, then no doubt he would be waving them in the air and screaming, while blood sprayed around the office space, leaving her colleagues screaming in horror. This is Roz Smith's life. She finds it boring in the extreme, a turgid turd of a life floating along a river of human excrement. This is not what she'd signed up for. This was not what she wanted at all. Now she stared at the computer screen and thought back to her time at college when she wore colourful clothes and tied ribbons in her hair. This vintage hippie look had lasted 6 months. Then she changed completely and turned goth, a look that more suited how she felt inside. Black and almost dead. The bright lipstick had vanished to be replaced with white foundation, her lips coated black with matching eyeshadow. Most of her teachers had been cool with it. After all, wasn't art all about expressing yourself? About being original? Although there was nothing original about being a goth. In truth, it was just another uniform to wear. Another constraint to make you feel even worse than you already did. A way of highlighting that you regularly considered suicide to escape this mundane world. She is thinking about the time they'd had to display their art for an open evening. Roz had worked on her painting for weeks, refusing to let any of the other students or even the teachers see it. And being art, they'd all been down with that. On the day of the unveiling, all the students had stood in front of their easels, some covered with sheets, just like Roz's. She'd been standing by the side of Ruben Jones and he'd smiled at her, and for some inexplicable reason she'd found herself smiling back with her bitumen black lips. Then the teacher had moved behind them. "Are you ready for your reveal, Ruben?" she'd asked. Her name had been Miss Miller, though of course she'd encouraged everyone to call her by her first name. "Yes, Millie, I'm ready," Ruben had replied. Roz tapped the keyboard, though her mind was still in the art studio, as Ruben whipped the sheet away, and Millie Miller had gasped at the image. Even Roz had been taken aback. The canvas had been painted garish red and orange. Over 100 images of babies' heads had been cut from magazines and pasted onto the canvas. Some of the babies had been smiling, others sucked on dummies. Some had one tooth in their gums, others had none.
"Wow, it's very striking," Millie Miller had said, her voice trembling slightly. "What's the title?"
"Babies in Hell."
Ross had looked at Ruben, and he'd once more smiled at her, and their eyes had met. And for the briefest moments, she'd felt the spark, felt the tiniest thrills pass through her body.
"Babies in Hell,"
Miss Miller had whispered, her complexion draining of colour. Ruben had nodded thoughtfully.
"I was going to call it Severed Babies' Heads in Hell, but I'm not out to shock," he'd explained.
Millie had shuffled to one side before placing a hand on Ross's shoulder, making her shiver.
"And what about you, Ross?" she'd asked.
Ross slowly pulled the sheet away.
"I called mine Barbecue Jesus."
Neither image had been used in the montage that had filled one wall of the classroom in the hope that it would encourage school leavers to join the art class. Now she smiled at the memory. Not long after the reveal, both she and Ruben had been approached by college counsellors to discuss any problems they might have been having at home. The truth was, Roz had plenty of problems at home and at college, though she'd politely refused the offer of help. She sighed as she thought of her parents. Her mother had been a nurse, and apparently a good one. That was until the day her father had his accident. Roz had been 14 when he'd slipped on the dog turd in the street. He had apparently been reading the Daily Mail at the time. The headline had been, "Queen looks radiant in yellow." Roz's father had taken to the air and landed awkwardly and, in the process, he'd broken his back. Now he was wheelchair-bound, his legs withering away. Though, to Roz's disbelief, he'd not let his disability define him and had thrown himself headlong into all sorts of different activities. These had included wheelchair tennis and basketball and even pottery, where the clay was stationary while the wheelchair occupant was spun around on a kind of flat roundabout. Her mother had been the one to take him to his various events, and on many occasions, Ross had been forced to go along to help. Back at home, she had one diary dedicated to killing her parents, especially her father. She could recall the first time they'd gone to the basketball club, and all the players had gathered around like drunks at an AA meeting.
"I'm one of the lucky ones. I was born without legs," one man had proclaimed.
Heads had nodded. One or two had used the word respect. Another had claimed to have been shot in the spine during a botched robbery. The hero had tried to stop a hardened criminal escaping from a post office with £50 from the till, half a dozen manila envelopes, plus a pack of multicoloured elastic bands. Ross had listened with a mounting sense of unease as the men all spoke up about their injuries.
"I lost the use of my legs during a potholing accident, but I managed to get everyone out before the cave roof gave way," another had claimed.
He'd been wearing a bandana and a t-shirt with an image of a monkey on the front smoking what looked like a cigar. Roz had looked him up and down. The man must have weighed close to 20 stone, and the thought of him squeezing himself down any narrow passage had seemed implausible. Then it had been her father's turn, and he'd puffed out his chest, his hands locked on the rims of his casual K-series wheelchair.
"Well, lads, the truth is I slipped on a dog turd after what I can only assume was that the Hound of the Baskervilles unloaded on the pavement outside Help the Aged. I went up around 6 feet and broke my back when I landed."
The room had fallen silent, and Roz had imagined pushing her father off a cliff into an angry sea in his speedmobile. Then the other men had been laughing and clapping, and her father had beamed, which had only made Roz reevaluate her image of her father plunging over the cliff. Now she imagined setting fire to him first before doing the deed. It would have been easier to cope with her father and his ailment if he wasn't so positive, so upbeat. As far as Roz was concerned, he had no right to be happy, especially without the use of his legs. For a while, she'd hoped that her mother would have asked her to help with some kind of home-assisted death,
a pillow over his face, too many painkillers, or simply letting him die through malnutrition. Anything other than having to witness his gurning smile that she was forced to see every day, or his whistling that he seemed to have taken up with as much vigour as the basketball or crazy wheelchair golf. The truth was, even when he'd been fully mobile, she'd never liked her father. He used to grate on her nerves with his ebullience, and when she'd been growing up, he'd always insisted she tried new things at regular intervals. Her fingers rested on the keys as she closed her eyes in anguish and thought of the clubs he used to take her to. From age 7 to 8, he wanted her to become a gymnast, and she had to go to Tumbles for Tots gym. That had been a disaster made worse by the fact that as a child, Roz Smith had been uncoordinated and a stone overweight for her age. Even now, the image of being stuck on top of the vault could make her want to kill with gay abandon. The other children, the thin ones, had snickered, and she'd cried before throwing herself headfirst to the crash mat to end her torment. Then her father had decided that although she'd never score a perfect 10 on the parallel bars, she could perhaps be a prima ballerina instead. So the next round of torment had begun. She'd been squeezed into a leotard and tutu, and in the process had broken 2 of her toes at home, and all because her father had told her she needed to practice her point. Though her toes hadn't been strong enough to bear her ever-increasing comfort-eating weight. She sighed and opened her eyes. She could see people starting to pack up their things, ready to head home for another day. Looking at the screen, she thought of Froom, and then switched the computer off and grabbed her coat, before heading for the door, without uttering a word to anyone.
Chapter 3. Ruben can hear the woman complaining, though as of yet he can't see her. He is standing on the platform, waiting for his train home, and he is fuming. It had been one of those days when the urge to kill had been seething inside. It had all started when the woman had come into the store, looking to buy her son a laptop.
"He's going to university, don't you know?"
To Ruben, the woman had looked grotesque, and the perfume she'd been wearing had been gag-inducing. "Actually, I don't know your son, so I'm afraid I was unaware that he is going to university," he'd replied. He had been hoping that the woman would spot the sarcasm in his voice, though he was sadly mistaken.
"Oh yes, he's doing fine arts. None of your modern or commercial rubbish. The real deal. He's very artistic, don't you know?"
Ruben didn't care whether the woman's son was artistic or not, and he'd stared at her blankly while picturing thrusting her head into a deep fat fryer. Though even that image had somehow made him feel worse rather than better, it had been unimaginative, second rate, not up to his usual standards at all.
"So I want something that suits my son's artistic needs," the woman had said before swishing her hair over one shoulder.
Ruben had pictured setting fire to her bleached blonde mane, and at last he'd smiled as he thought of her screaming and dashing about among the white goods and large screen televisions, the stink of burning hair filling the air. "Do you have a budget?" he'd asked.
"Money is no object," she'd replied loftily, before looking him up and down,
her expression like the one people use when they see an alcoholic dressed in rags vomiting in the street. Ruben had gone into salesman mode. There would be plenty of time later to imagine her demise. The woman had left after spending almost £3,000 on a computer, printer, and assorted software that her precious son would ever need. Ruben had even thrown in a Paint the Bob Ross Way arts box, holding acrylic paints, 1 2-inch and 1 3-inch brush, plus a canvas at no extra charge. The rest of the day had been spent trying to avoid the customers. Now here he stands, with people jostling on either side. The woman is still complaining, and for the first time he catches sight of her. For a few seconds he felt confused. It was the woman who had spent the £3,000 earlier in the day, and she was on the phone, her voice strident.
I don't care. You promised me that the Jaguar would have been serviced by 5, and yet here I am having to catch a train because of your stupidity.
Listen to her, a stuck-up bitch, a woman to Ruben's right whispered to her friend. He waited to see how the friend would respond.
If I owned a Jag and had to catch the train, then I wouldn't be happy either, she'd eventually replied.
Suppose so,
the complainer admitted as the train pulled into the station. Ruben could smell them both. In fact, everyone around him seemed to stink. The perfume and aftershave mingled in the station air, along with the stink of cigarette smoke and body odour. In the past, he'd wondered if the fact that he was a serial killer meant his sense of smell was more acute than your average person. He had spent time online trying to find out if other killers from the past had any kind of heightened response to smells. In the end, he'd given up searching. After all, what did it really matter? The truth was, he could smell them all, and he hated it. Then the train doors opened, and he shuffled forward, one of the crowd, one of the collective. And when he reached the doors, he suddenly found that he couldn't get on the train. This had happened before, numerous times, and he'd learnt to accept it, though it still annoyed him. He felt people move around him as they got into the carriage, and then the doors closed, and he was left alone. Apart from the woman he'd served earlier that day. For some reason, she was still on the platform. The bags that held all the equipment she'd bought were placed around her feet. Ruben looked down at her footwear. He had a thing for shoes. It had started when he was a child, and he would sniff his mother's slippers. They had always had the same odour, talcum powder, and a strange rodent-like smell with a base scent of TCP. The woman on the phone was wearing blue shoes with a stiletto heel in what looked like silver metal, and he pictured slamming the high heel into her eye, driving it deep until it skewered her inconsequential brain.
Right, well, I shall wait here at the station, and you will have to carry my bags to the car, because there's no way I'm doing it, she snapped into the bejeweled iPhone.
Ruben watched as she stabbed at the screen with a bright green nail to end the call. Then she glanced over her shoulder and looked him up and down with zero recognition in her eyes. Ruben pondered the possibility that it was because he was wearing his jacket and hat that stopping her from recognizing him. Then he decided that was not the case. The truth was, she does not recognize him, because as far as she is concerned, he is not worth remembering.
What are you looking at?
She suddenly asked in a brusque tone. Ruben made no reply, and that's because he is thinking things through, as well as having an acute sense of smell. He is also spatially aware of what or who is around him. It is another gift, another bonus. Right now, he knew that he was alone on the platform, apart from the woman who glared at him before turning away. Ruben checked his watch and smiled to himself. Around here, the trains usually ran on time, which was something of a miracle, and he knew that the next one would arrive in 2 minutes' time. Stifling a yawn, he thought about the disappointment of his lunch. He had, as always, sat alone in the refectory at his usual corner table. On his way to work, he'd called at the M&S food outlet store and bought himself a salmon and cucumber sandwich. According to the 100% recyclable box it came in, the salmon was of the Wild Atlantic variety, line-caught. The granary bread had been made to an old recipe using artisan flour, the cucumber having been grown organically. He had also bought a yogurt made with milk from cows raised on the lush grasslands of Guernsey and containing Scottish raspberries. Halfway through the sandwich, he'd found a salmon bone, and his rage had been instant, his hand shaking as he threw the remains into the bin. The yogurt had just about stopped him from losing the plot completely. The flavour had been wonderful, though he'd got a raspberry seed stuck between his front teeth, which had annoyed the hell out of him. Now he tilted his head as he heard the faint metallic hum. The train was coming, and on time, as usual. He started to count down the seconds, knowing that this train wouldn't be stopping at the station, which for once was a bonus. Reuben Jones's timing had always been good, and when he pushed the woman onto the track, he knew that by the time he reached the steps that led back to the road, she would be dead. He heard her scream once, and then the train was hurtling by, and he glanced over his shoulder. All that remained were the bags on the edge of the platform, along with one blue stiletto shoe. Suddenly, the day didn't seem so bad at all, and by the time he reached the road, he was whistling, head down, the peak of the cap hiding his features as he headed for the bus stop.
Chapter 4.
By the time Roz arrived home, it was dark, and she stood on the drive hidden by the bushes, wishing with every fibre of her being that she didn't have to go into the hated house. Over the years, she tried several ways of sneaking into her parents' home without being seen, yet it always seemed to end in failure. Since the accident, her father had become adept at moving through the house at speed in his wheelchair. As soon as he heard the click of the door, he would appear, his stupid beaming smile fixed in place, his withered legs dangling, wearing hush puppies despite the fact he would never walk again. "How's my gymnast? How's my ballerina?" he would usually ask as he blocked the hallway. "I've had a busy day and I can't be bothered with you," was her standard reply, as she fantasised that her father's speedmobile was the plug-in variety, just like old Sparky. "Well, your tea's ready and it's Friday, so it's your favourite," he would proclaim. "Fish fingers, chips and beans." Roz could feel the fury bloom inside as she hid among the foliage. She wished that just for once a Friday would arrive and it would be a real fish on her plate, not the mechanically reformed mash of fish guts and sewage from an outlet pipe that dumped human excrement into the sea. Alas, that had never happened, and she suspected it never would, at least not while her father was alive. She thought back to her teenage years. She'd lost the weight she'd been carrying as a child, though by that time she'd been too old for gym or ballerina lessons. Besides, her father had given up on her. By the time she reached 15, he'd stopped trying to choose her hobbies for her. This was, in part, due to the fact that he'd been coming to terms with the accident and finding that being wheelchair-bound was not so bad after all. After the fall, her parents had got themselves a solicitor, and they'd taken the council to court and won a 5-figure settlement. Her father had been ecstatic at the news, and Roz had wanted to murder the solicitor for doing such a decent job. Basically, it had meant that her father never had to work again. He was always at home, always wheeling himself about silently. She would hear him outside her bedroom, and she knew he would be leaning over with his ear close to the door, and the thought of it made her skin crawl. She dreamt of being on the other side, the shotgun held at waist height as she pulled the trigger, blowing a hole in the door and splattering her father's brains all over the beige-coloured wall. His death was something she prayed for. Even though she had no belief in any god, she believed in hedging her bets. Though, so far, if God did exist, then he wasn't listening to her. At her back, she heard a car go by on the road as the solitary tear slipped from her eye. Here she was, 28 years old and still living at home, with not a hope of earning enough money to find a place of her own. What made matters worse was the fact that she knew her parents could have helped her with a deposit, and yet they refused to. And she knew exactly why. Her father wanted her there always. He never wanted her to leave, though it had nothing to do with love. No. It was down to the fact that he loved to torment her. It made his life worth living to know that she had nowhere to go, had no friends or lovers, and she knew that he would happily see her grow into an old woman, still stuck within the four walls of the hated house. Her mother, on the other hand, didn't want Roz to move out because that would mean she'd be left alone with a man she despised. Roz had discovered this fact when she'd found her mother's diary one day while they were out. Her father had been trying his hand at cake decorating for the disabled. She'd found the diary in her mother's wardrobe, high up on a shelf, well away from her husband's grasp. The diary itself had been in a shoebox, along with a purple dildo,
and for a few minutes, Rose had felt an affinity with her mother. And then she'd started to read the diary. Though most of the pages had held the same mantra. I hate you, Malcolm fucking Smith, and I wish you were dead. Line after line, page after page of the same words. The only difference being the amount of exclamation marks her mother had used. Most had just the one, but she did count several that had two, and one had over seven. In some ways, Roz had thought that the discovery would have left her feeling sympathy for her mother. After all, it proved that they felt the same way about the man they shared the house with. Hated husband, hated father. Though, in truth, it only made her hate her mother more. She was being selfish. She was thinking about herself and not her daughter. She was as bad as her dad, both holding her prisoner for their own nefarious reasons. When it started to rain, she remained in the bushes, too furious to approach the house, too livid to face either one of them. So, she turned and made her way back to the road, the rain falling heavily, yet she didn't care. She was lost in her own dark thoughts of murder, picturing herself using the frenzied axe attack to go on the rampage, leaving them both dead, blood coating the walls and floor. She imagined body parts severed, a leg here, an arm there, fingers in the fish tank. Fish fingers, your favourite! She heard her father's jovial voice, and she gritted her teeth as she walked. Ross Smith felt furious and impotent, and suddenly the diaries were not enough. Suddenly, she knew she would have to do something about her pitiful situation or die trying.
Chapter 5. Over time, Ruben had learnt that being a serial killer went hand in hand with routine. His mother had been the same. She'd been one of those people who simply had to clean things. As far as he was aware, she'd never gone on to kill anyone, but she'd cleaned like a demon. The first time he'd realised this fact, he'd been 10 years old and off school with chickenpox, and she'd come into the bathroom while he'd been sitting on the toilet, his striped pyjama bottoms around his ankles. Most boys at that age would have been horrified to find their mother standing there with bleach bottle in hand, sporting pink marigold gloves, though the truth was he'd simply looked at her blankly.
It's 10:17, she'd claimed.
Ruben had been perplexed by her words, and he'd done his best to ignore her and concentrated on the job at hand, feeling the usual sense of satisfaction when he heard the plop in the water.
It's now 10:18.
Her frown had turned into a scowl. 2 minutes later, he'd exited the bathroom after washing his hands, leaving his mother squirting bleach into the toilet with a kind of manic determination. Now Ruben sits at his kitchen table. The plate is in front of him. It had 2 same-sized potatoes, 42 garden peas, and 2 sausages with just a hint of rosemary. Inside, he can feel the annoyance grow. Having dropped 2 peas to the kitchen floor with the wire scoop, he'd been forced to get 2 more from the bag in the freezer and wait 3:20 for them to cook. Many would see this as an illness, though Ruben thinks no such thing. His mother's obsession with cleaning had been an illness, while his was simply routine. He eyed the glass of apple juice with 1 ice cube floating in it. He'd once tried urine therapy, though the taste hadn't been appealing, so now he used the apple juice as a faux replacement. The house is silent, apart from the squeak-squeak coming from the lounge as Mrs. Bumpf the hamster goes around in her wheel. Lifting the knife and fork, he speared 1 pea and popped it into his mouth as he once more thought about his mother. In the end, her obsessions had led to insanity, and he knew he'd played his part in her incarceration. There was fun to be had with someone who suffered from compulsive obsession disorders. This could include moving an ornament a fraction of an inch, or even better, blocking the Hoover pipe with a foreign object. After much testing, he'd found that a thick winter sock or pair of underpants worked best. Both had been guaranteed to send his mother into a meltdown of mammoth proportions. He cut the sausages into slices, ate from each sausage before eating a slice. He smiled as he recalled how she would panic as she tried to remove the blockage. She would have one eye on the clock as the second finger ticked past the allotted time when she'd to start hoovering. If he'd done his job right, then she would begin to sweat, her movements becoming more frantic as she shook the pipe, her teeth gnawing at her bottom lip, occasionally drawing blood, which had always been a bonus. On one occasion, her distress had been so acute that she jumped into the car and dashed into town to buy another vacuum cleaner. An hour later, she'd returned home, and then she'd broken down, crying on the stairs, as she realized that she'd forgot to buy dust bags to go with the machine. Ruben ate another slice of sausage and four more peas as he relived those happy days. He could have carried on for years, but at the age of 15, his mother had tried to kill him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.